Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. My name is Pastor Diane Chesluck, and on behalf of the people of Dakota-Riverside and La Crescent United Methodist Churches, we welcome you to this time of worship. We pray that this time may be a blessing to your heart, to your soul, and to your life, and that together we can uplift and praise the name of Jesus. If you are a regular attender of worship here with either Dakota Riverside or La Crescent, we invite you to continue to support the ministries of the church through your prayers, your presence, your gifts, and your service, and most importantly, your witness. If you go to the La Crescent United Methodist webpage, you can find the addresses for both congregations, and you can send in your financial gift to those addresses. While we await the time that we can again worship together in person, we invite you to lift God's name as we join in our call to worship.
Come, all who are hungry and thirsty.
The Lord will provide for our needs.
Come this day to the table of the Lord.
Here we will find welcome and sustenance.
Come to this time of gathering and praise.
Lord, we come with open hearts and spirits to receive your gracious gifts of love. Amen.
We all start on the outside looking in. This is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give, all the shape that we were in. And just when all hope seems lost, love opened the door for us. He said, all who hunger, all who thirst, all who last and
Let us pray. Holy One, we bow our hearts before you this day. Strengthen us in our innermost being and dwell in our hearts through faith. May we be rooted and grounded in Christ, whose love is beyond all knowledge. Help us comprehend even the smallest part of the beautiful mystery of your grace. Grant that we may experience the fullness of your presence with us. Amen.
Our scripture lesson today is from Luke chapter 14, verses 7 through 14. When he noticed how the guests chose the places of honor, he told them a parable. When you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor in case someone more distinguished than you has been invited by your host. And the host who invited both of you may come and say to you, give this person your place, and then in disgrace you would start to take the lowest place. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he may say to you, friend, move up higher. Then you will be honored in the presence of all who sit at the table with you. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. He said also to the one who had invited him, when you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed, because they cannot repay you, for you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous.
Enter into the second week of our sermon series, Come to the Table. My title, Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, reflects a film based in 1967, starring the likes of Spencer Tracy, Sidney Poitier, Katharine Hepburn, and Katherine Houghton. In this film, the daughter of a well-to-do white family, Joanna Drayton, comes home from a vacation to announce her intention of marrying a well-to-do black physician, John Prentice. The plot thickens as Joanna brings John home to dinner to meet her parents, who do not know that he is black. John's parents also come to dinner to meet her parents in order to meet Joanna and her parents, and they learn at the airport that she is white. This might not be such a big deal today, but in 1967, to present a positive representation of a controversial subject like interracial marriage was very bold. Bold because historically interracial marriage was illegal in most states and was still illegal in 17 states until June 12th of 1967. This movie represents a cultural taboo of that time, and it does so around the dinner table because who's at the table says something about who's in and who's out. The table is not just the place where one may say grace. It's the space where one extends grace. Tables in the ancient world were places where philosophers and teachers would impart their wisdom. Tables were also the place where a community's identity could be marked. A Near Eastern proverb declares, "I saw them eating, and I knew who they were." And this was not necessarily about one's distinct way of chewing food. One's eating company says something about you and your company as well. To the gospel writer Luke, there is nothing more serious than a dining table. The Eucharist, or the Lord's Supper, and the revelations of the risen Christ occur there. And here, Jesus promises the Holy Spirit while he is eating. Jews and Gentiles reflect the nature of the church through table fellowship, as we see in Acts. And the table is taken so seriously that Jesus gets into trouble because of who he eats with. He is known as a friend of tax collectors, or publicans, and sinners because he ate with them. Inviting others to a table could be a sign of affluence or status, but it could also be a sign of service or a sign of acceptance as equals, creating open fellowship through the breaking of the bread. Table fellowship meant full acceptance of one another and the inclusiveness of Jesus revealed by the company that he kept, especially of those who were ostracized in the social stature. It was often found suspect by those in community. Going to the other's house was bad enough, but to eat at the same table was a whole nother thing. You see, the table says something about who's in and who's out. So, who's at the table? This is the most obvious part of this parable in Luke. Jesus begins by teaching guests about table manners when he says, when you are invited by someone to a wedding banquet, do not sit down at the place of honor. But when you are invited, go and sit down at the lowest place. Social status was obviously based on the seating of dinner guests. And Jesus tells the guests to seek the lower place so that the host may tell them, move up higher. He thought that if you humble yourselves, you will be exalted, and if you exalt yourself, you'll be humbled. This story here about hospitality involves humility, the humility of the guests. If you think about it, you know, this way of seating at a table is so different than the way that we often do things in our society. I thought a little bit about how we are accepted into college, maybe because I have a daughter who is now in college. You oftentimes don't get yourself into college because you majored in humility or sitting at the least part of the table. When filling out an application, we're advised to put our best foot forward, to highlight our strengths, to talk about our accomplishments and our skills, to name the awards that we've received, to elevate ourselves to stand out among the highly other competent applicants. No one in today's day and age emphasizes humility as a means to getting a job or getting into college. The apparent goal of our society is to show that we are at the top of our game, our field, or our school. Jesus, however, flips the script by saying one should aim to go as low as one can go. This humble posture is not just for the guests. Jesus also tells the host to look as well at themselves. When you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or your rich neighbors, in case they may invite you in return, and you would be repaid. But when you give a banquet, he says, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, and you will be blessed because they cannot repay you. Guess who's coming to dinner? Not your friends or your brothers or your relatives or your rich neighbors, but strangers and the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind, those from whom we cannot get anything in return for our hospitality, those who have no social or economic status, those who can't help us get connected to the influential, those who are not the usual suspects around the table of welcome. In the kingdom of God, we see the turning of hospitality, in which those on the margins are placed front and center at the table, to remind us that community is only as strong as its weakest member. Those on the fringes become friends through table fellowship. This ought to be surprising because the kingdom of God, this ought not to be surprising because the kingdom of God is always overturning the usual way of thinking. In the kingdom, Jesus says that hospitality is free and there is no expectation of return. It's unconditional service at the table. There's no strings attached and no stipulations placed on those who gather at the table. Except for what the Yale theologian Miroslav Vlach calls the drama of embrace. I believe this is the only thing that is asked for at the table. The drama of embrace. This embrace, Vlach says, will give to us and give ourselves, allow us to give ourselves to the other and welcome them, to readjust our identities to make space for them, prior to any judgments about others except that of identifying them in their humanity. The will to embrace, he said, precedes any truth about others and any construction of their justice. Hospitality, he says, is creating space. Space to embrace the other. And it's not to change people, but to offer them space where change can take place. That is from Henry Nouwen. A space where change can take place. The invitation list is already a huge change from the norm, because those invited to this table are different from, even strange compared to those of the host. But isn't that what hospitality is? The welcome of the stranger? The welcome of difference? Having the other at the table? Friends, having the other at the table is not just a nice thing to do. It's the right thing to do. In fact, it oftentimes makes for a better table. When I was growing up, I have shared with you before that my dad was a city bus driver. And my dad would often make friends with people that were working in town for a short time or coming to school in the Duluth Superior area. And he would make friends with people that oftentimes don't have a lot of other community. And especially around the holidays, my dad would extend hospitality to people. So we always knew when Thanksgiving or Christmas or Easter or other big gatherings came around that we were always to have an empty spot at the table for someone. We never knew who that person would be, never knew if it was going to be one or two or 10, but we always had room around the table, always had more than enough around the table. We were able to bridge some beautiful relationships through the years. People who had been in the Duluth Superior area for a short time and then would move away, but would keep in contact with our family because of that connection that they had around the table. It wasn't necessarily about what was served around the table, but having people who were open to embracing them. You see, the table is about having people around the table who don't look like us, act like us, talk like us, think like us, vote like us, live like us, sing like us, dance like us, people who are not us, people who are people. And when we have people who are not like us around the table, we are better able to understand the beauty of God in a better way. Because each person around the table, no matter who they are, no matter what they do, no matter where they live, no matter what they wear, are creation of God. You see, difference and diversity undergirds a beautiful community in which distinct perspectives inform and illuminate one another. And when we have that drama of embrace, we're linked into the hospitality of the kingdom of God. Jesus, I think, was trying to tell us here that sameness is not a sign of the kingdom. Nowhere does Jesus say that the goal is sameness or a monolithic same guest lists of people who are like us. Jesus doesn't even guilt us into meeting the needs of the poor, the crippled, the lame, or the blind. But he does say that we are to invite them. Have them as part of your community of friends, my friend. And you'll be blessed because they cannot repay you. You'll be blessed just because they're around the table, just because they are them. And believe it or not, when you have others who are different around the table, the fear of others who are different from you goes away. Even though it appears that there might be what we oftentimes the preferential option for the poor, Jesus doesn't say that. He says that we should have all around the table. He doesn't say that those who are religious and those who have money and wealthy should disappear from the table. He says all should be welcomed around the table. Jesus speaks to everyone, both the guests and the hosts, the privileged and the underprivileged, about the table, about hospitality, because hospitality is the practice by which the church stands or falls. It is that important, my friend. The table is an invaluable tool. And not only who's at the table, which is pretty obvious, but whose table it really is. For you see, this table is not the table of La Crescent United Methodist Church. It's not the table of the United Methodist Church. It is not the table of the United Methodist Annual Conference of the state of Minnesota. This table belongs to Christ. It's Christ's table. And we, my friends, need to understand that when Christ gives the invitation to all, we have to welcome all at the table. It's the table of Jesus Christ, who is both host and guest, the humble and the exalted one. When he talks about the feast, it's a feast about the kingdom of God in the kingdom of God. And we have to understand that what he is getting at here is the larger literary context of this banquet table is talking about the kingdom of God. The table speaks about the way that the character of the kingdom of God is going to turn everything upside down. When those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. Where the last will be first, and the first will be last. He says that the kingdom, they'll come from the east, from the west, from the north to the south to sit at this welcome table. You don't have to worry about not being invited because God invites everyone to this wedding banquet. And I might even say some Packer fans too. Everyone is invited to God's table, even our enemies. Friends, that says something about God's hospitality. It doesn't discriminate. God is a host who hosts us in this world from our very first breath to our last, and says that no matter who you are, no matter what you've done, no matter what you do, you are welcome at this table. And I know that that is a hospitality that is risky. So risky that in the images of the Last Supper, we see Jesus sitting at a table with his disciples, including Judas. Judas Iscariot, the one who would betray him. His caress of love, inviting all to the table, crushed him in the end at the cross. One must remember that this table talk happens as Jesus is headed to Jerusalem, where he will be killed, merging both his hospitality and the hostility of the world. If you look at the word hospitality, the makeup of the word contains the word hostile in it, revealing to us that risk is built into the very fabric of hospitality because it contains its opposite within it. The risk of hospitality causes Jesus to have a run-in with a cross because hospitality says, let the other come here. Let me turn the world upside down and tell you what the kingdom of God is all about. Hospitality may invert things or even convert things, for we know that the suffering of Jesus as an example is redemptive and purposeful. Even though this hospitality kills him, it affirms what Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said is unearned suffering can be redemptive. Jesus reveals the vulnerable nature of hospitality while revealing that hostility could not hold him hostage forever in a cold, dark grave. You see, the very table that brings life, that brings grace, that brings hope, is also the one that leads us to a place where we know Jesus paid it all for us. And we're not asked to repay. We're not asked to repay God for that hospitality. Nor could we ever repay him for the gift of love and life. His hospitality comes with no strings attached, for his banquet is free. And we don't even know what's being served at the table. But we know who's coming to dinner and whose dinner table it is. I wonder why we're not told what was served at the banquet, or what will be served at the banquet. Perhaps the lack of focus on food shifts the focus onto the people at the table, because that's what's most important. Perhaps the silence about the menu suggests that Jesus is our bread and food at the welcome table, and thus all of our needs will be met. And it's a call for us to trust God to provide for our daily bread. Or maybe, just maybe, we're not told what is on the table because it's an invitation to us to help set the table and serve what we will share at the table. Because the food, the menu is not mentioned, does not mean that it's insignificant, my friends, because we know that food is important. Amen? The lack of mention of what food is on the table gives us freedom to decide what to serve. So what do we serve when we sit together at the table? What will you put on the table? This story invites us to help prepare the menu for the welcome table. And Luke, our gospel writer, is being hospitable towards us by calling us to participate in this parable, to nudge us, to help host others, and to participate in and extend God's hospitality throughout the world and this community by being God's co-laborers. I believe, again, at some point in our life, when this pandemic lets up, we will share food again at some point. But I wonder, what will you share at the table, other than food, with those who are different from you? Maybe you'll sit at the table and exchange new ideas about a social issue, or draw on personal insights into how we have faithfully lived in and through this pandemic. Maybe you'll cooperate and work together on community issues that are rising around us. Maybe you'll share in friendship with someone whom you haven't yet met. Maybe you'll give someone an open ear of understanding when no one else will. Maybe you'll share your heart with all of its hopes and dreams for the future. Maybe you'll take the risk to share yourself to welcome someone in order to give them a sense of belonging, to affirm their value, and to assure them that they are loved. Maybe, just maybe, you'll share more than food at the welcome table, and through your hospitality, you'll be blessed. Friends, the menu is clearly not yet set, but the Holy Host, with a G-H, has invited us all to sit at the welcome table. Not just one of these days, but today, this very day. You may be surprised who's on the guest list. You may be pleasantly surprised by what you find served at the table. So, friends, at this table, bon appetit. Amen. As we respond to God in this time, I invite you to be in an attitude of prayer, a time of silence where you calm all of the thoughts, ideas, demands that are going on in your heart and head, and take a time of silence to listen for the voice of God. Gracious and holy God, you are a God of hospitality. There is none like you that invites all to come to you. You have invited all to your home, to your table, and to your arms. Lord, would that all would hear and receive this good news, we pray. Help us to remember that no one is better than anyone else in your kingdom. And help us to treat each other the way you treat all people. Generous God, because you treat us with your tender love, we take time to pray for our friends, our family members, and others who need you more than ever. Pour out your healing on all who need it, and be generous with your transforming love for those whose needs are great this day. Bring about your reconciliation in families, in communities, in this country, throughout this world where it is needed. You give us, O God, the gifts of the Spirit to use to further your kingdom and to be the body of Christ in the world. We take time to remember the people who have been devastated by wildfires and storms, and to thank you for the way that you have sent people to heal their communities. Empower us, O God, to continue to be your hands and feet, to continue the work that needs to be done here and in so many other places in the world. There is none like you, God, in your love and in your generosity, your gifting and your hospitality. And we thank you that you are in our lives, working in and through us, to let people to know your kingdom is open for all. We pray, O God, that in the name of your Son, who opened the doors for all and broke down those barriers that kept people from you, we may continue to do your work. Hear us now as we pray the words your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
forth with the love of God, sharing hope and hospitality with all that you meet. Go forth with the grace of Christ, giving kindness and compassion to a world in need. Go now, and may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go and remain with you now and always. Amen. Thank you for joining us, and have a great week.